Hello students, welcome to zoology classroom. In today's class, we are going to discuss about mechanism of homeostasis, in particularly regulation of blood glucose levels. So in the previous class, we have seen about the concept of homeostasis. So in that class, we have discussed about the concept of homeostasis in detail. Let us once again recollect that. Homeostasis is a life process by which a steady state of internal environment will be maintained in the bodies of living organisms. And this internal environment comprises of two components. One is physical conditions, another one is chemical conditions. Physical conditions include temperature, body volume, blood pressure, heart rate, etc. And chemical conditions include water levels in the body fluids, ionic concentrations, pH, blood glucose levels, oxygen levels, and carbon dioxide levels. So all these values, they are having a normal range. And this normal range of values must be maintained in our body in order to be healthy and fit. So if the normal range is not maintained, then that will be causing to the many problems to the individual. So maintaining that normal levels is called as homeostasis, and several methods of maintaining this homeostasis are there. Those means or methods are osmoregulation, thermoregulation, blood glucose levels regulation and buffering mechanisms, regulation of oxygen and carbon dioxide levels, and regulation of blood volume and heart rate. So out of these things, we have already discussed about osmoregulation process. In today's class, we are going to discuss about blood glucose levels regulation. And in next class, we are going to discuss about thermoregulation process. So coming to the blood glucose levels, so blood glucose levels should be maintained under a normal range. The normal range when we are on fasting is 70 to 110 milligram per deciliter. And normal range when we are having, when we had immediately after the meals are taking food, normal range is 120 to 140 milligram deciliter. So these two normal ranges, they are having a lower value and higher value. And the blood glucose levels, when they are below the lower values and when they are above the higher values, both these two conditions are not normal. They are called abnormalities. And these abnormalities, they have got some specific terms, terminology, names. And when the blood glucose levels are above the normal range, higher the normal values, then that condition is called as hyperglycemia. This hyperglycemia is also called as sugar disease. Or this hyperglycemic condition continues for a long period of time, then that is called as sugar disease or diabetes mellitus. And when the blood glucose levels are below the normal ranges, that is called as hypoglycemia. If hypoglycemia stays for a few days or 1-2 days, that is not a big problem. But hypoglycemia condition and hyperglycemia condition, both the condition, if they are staying in our body for a long period of time, then that is going to cause a lot of trouble. So that's why the normal range of blood glucose must be maintained. So to maintain that thing, several hormones are there, and these several hormones they are glucagon, insulin, somatostatin. These three hormones are released by pancreas, and adrenocorticotropic hormone ACTH, growth hormone GH. These two hormones are released by pituitary gland, and epinephrine and cortisol. These two hormones are released by adrenal gland, and thyroxine hormone. This is released by thyroid gland. These total seven hormones, they help us to regulate blood glucose levels. And what are the factors contributing to the maintenance of blood glucose levels? Is that three factors: glycogenolysis, diet, gluconeogenesis. These three factors help us to increase blood glucose levels. So diet is the major factor. So through diet, we eat food that will be digested. After digested, it will be absorbed through absorption. All the glucose enters into the blood only. So this diet is the major source for the blood glucose levels maintaining. And when we are on fasting, when we do not take food for 12 to 18 hours of time, then glycogenolysis will occur with the help of glycogen, with the help of glucagon hormone. So in this process, glycogen, which is present in liver and muscle cells, will be converted into glucose. That glucose from these liver cells and muscle cells comes into blood. The blood glucose levels will be increased. And through gluconeogenesis also, this occurs when we are on fasting for a prolonged period of time. Say, for example, more than 18 hours or more than one day. If you do not take food for more than one day, then all the amino acid, many amino acids, proteins, and fatty acids in your body will participate in gluconeogenesis mechanism. Through this mechanism, amino acids, fatty acids will be converted into glucose. All that glucose molecules, they come into blood. Thus, blood glucose levels will be increased. So these three factors, they help us to increase our blood glucose levels. And what are the three factors that help us to decrease blood glucose levels are oxidation or cellular respiration. This includes glycolysis, Krebs cycle, electron transport, oxidative phosphorylation processes. And another one is glycogenesis process. Third one is lipogenesis process. So once the blood glucose level crossed the normal range, that means blood glucose levels have been increased the normal levels, then all the extra or additional glucose molecules, they enter into the cells. And after entering into the cells, they will participate in cellular respiration or oxidation process. So after participating this thing in oxidation also, if excess glucose is there, that excess glucose will be participated in glycogenesis process or lipogenesis process. If the excess glucose is in adipose tissues, there it will participate in lipogenesis. That excess glucose will be converted into lipids, and that lipids will be stored in adipose tissue. Other than adipose tissue, the excess glucose will participate in glycogenesis. Through this glycogenesis, what is happening? Additional glucose will be stored in the form of glycogen. So after entering into the cells, if the cells require energy, the glucose enters into oxidation process, releases ATP energy. So if additional glucose is there, it participates in glycogenesis and glycogen will be formed. In adipose tissue, additional or excess glucose participates in lipogenesis, that finally results in the formation of lipids. So like this, these three processes help us to decrease the blood glucose levels when blood glucose levels are above the normal range. And these are the seven hormones. We have seen about them already. So next one, let us see about the three hormones of pancreas. We know that pancreas is a mixed gland. It is having endocrine portion and apocrine portion. Exocrine portion. So in endocrine portion, it is having islets of Langerhans cells. There are three types of cells present in islets of Langerhans. They are alpha cells, beta cells, and delta cells. Alpha cells will secrete glucagon hormone, beta cells secrete insulin hormone, delta cells secrete somatostatin hormone. The glucagon helps us to increase the blood glucose levels. When we are having a blood glucose levels below the normal range. So when the blood glucose levels below the normal range, then this glucagon will be released and it helps us to increase the blood glucose level. When the blood glucose levels are above normal range, higher blood glucose levels are there, then insulin will be released. It helps us to decrease the increased glucose levels. And this delta cells that secrete somatostatin, it regulates alpha cells and beta cells. Finally, it will help us to increase the blood glucose level. Another cells, F cells, also will be there in pancreas. They will secrete a polypeptide hormone. This inhibits the secretion of digestive enzymes. So this is related to digestion process, but not the regulation of blood glucose level. Next, some more details about insulin. It is a peptide hormone. It regulates the metabolism of carbohydrates, fats, and proteins also. It promotes the absorption of glucose into the skeletal muscle cells and fat muscles and fat tissue and all cells also. Okay, so this insulin promotes the absorption of glucose into all types of cells. Mostly glucose will be absorbed by skeletal muscle cells and fat tissue and liver also. So, and it also promotes the formation of fats, and it inhibits the utilization of fatty acids in energy generation or in oxidation process. And metabolic effects of this insulin. So this insulin enhances the entry of glucose into cells. Let us see how this insulin is helping the glucose to enter into the cells. So watch carefully, carefully observe this diagram. So through this digestive system, we take food in and this will be digested. So digested food will be converted into glucose. Finally, glucose will be absorbed into the bloodstream. So these red color dots are glucose molecules. Now they are in blood. So when the blood glucose goes above the normal range, then this pancreas secretes insulin hormone. So this insulin hormone is shown as a blue color dots. So this insulin hormone, it also comes into the bloodstream. And after coming into the bloodstream, these glucose molecules and insulin molecules, they go into the tissue fluid from this blood vessels. These glucose molecules and insulin molecules enter into tissue fluid. So now glucose molecules are high in this tissue fluid, but glucose cannot go into the cells. So to enter into the cells, it requires the help of insulin. So now what insulin will do? Insulin attaches with the receptors present on the plasma membrane of the cell. So this insulin molecules, they go and bind with the receptors of the cells. When the insulin binds with the receptors, then only the permeability of this plasma membrane for glucose will be increased. Then glucose will be allowed to enter into the cell. When insulin is not there, plasma membrane will not allow the glucose enter into the cells. So in other cases, we have seen in digestion absorption process to enter into the blood from this lumen of the digestive system, glucose takes the help of sodium ion. Okay, from here also, from blood vessel to into this tissue fluid, to enter into the tissue fluid also, sodium will be helping the glucose molecule to go out of the blood vessel to enter into this tissue fluid. But to enter into the cell, sodium is not going to help the glucose. Here, glucose requires the help of insulin. When insulin binds with the receptor cells, then only the plasma membrane allows the glucose to go inside the cell. So like this way, this insulin is increasing the permeability of the membrane. Like that, it is helping the glucose enter into the cells. Mostly this glucose enter into skeletal cells, liver, and fat tissue or adipose tissue. And after entering into the cell also, the excess glucose will be converted into glycogen by glycogenesis process. The excess glucose in adipose tissue will be converted into fatty acids by lipogenesis process. And this insulin also enhances the synthesis of fatty acids and proteins. So fats and proteins will be synthesized with the help of insulin. These will not be broken down. Okay, these fats and proteins will not be broken down when insulin is present on the cells. So all these activities finally helping us to lower the blood glucose levels till normal level comes. So when insulin will be released, when we are having higher blood glucose levels than normal value, then only insulin will release. Then insulin goes to the cells and it promotes all these activities. by doing all these activities, it is helping us to lower the blood glucose levels. So till the normal level, till the normal blood glucose level comes, till then insulin will be there. Then later insulin production will be stopped. Next hormone is somatostatin. Somatostatin is also called as a growth hormone, inhibiting hormone, or somatotrophin release inhibiting factor, or somatotrophin release inhibiting hormone. This is also a peptide hormone like insulin. It regulates endocrine system. It affects neurotransmission or action potential transmissions. It also affects the cell proliferation. Cell proliferation means cell divisions, mitosis, meiosis, all these processes also will be affected by somatostatin. And all these activities will be performed by somatostatin by the interaction with G protein coupled somatostatin receptors. So all the cells will having some special receptors. All these special receptors are called as G protein coupled somatostatin receptors. By binding with these receptors, somatostatin is doing all these activities. So it is inhibiting the release of secondary hormones. It is inhibiting the release of insulin and glucagon hormones. So, and finally, it is suppressing the glucagon release from alpha cells. It suppresses the release of insulin hormones. So several different types of these activities are quite contrary to each other also. So, and it also suppresses the release of pituitary trophic hormones, gastrin hormone, and secretin hormone. So several effects are there that can be exerted by somatostatin hormone. Finally, it is helping us to lower the blood glucose levels. Next one is glucagon. It is also a peptide hormone, will be secreted by alpha cells of pancreas. It raises the concentration of blood, glucagon raises when the blood glucose levels go below the normal level. So when the blood glucose level go below the normal level, then glucagon will be released. Then it will try to raise the concentration of glucose in the blood. So when blood glucose levels go below normal level, then it raises the concentration of blood glucose, or glucose levels will be increased. So it is opposite in action to insulin hormone. So insulin increases the glucose permeability. And it is helping the glucose to be converted into glucagon by glycogenesis. Glycogen by glycogenesis process. So here glucagon hormone is promoting the glycogenolysis process. So by glycogenolysis, this glycogen will be converted into glucose. So this glucose enters into the bloodstream. Thus, additional glucose coming from the cells increases the blood glucose levels. So metabolic effect of this thing is that it will be released when the blood glucose levels are below the normal levels. And it converts the glycogen into glucose. And it enhances the synthesis of glucose from amino acids and fatty acids also. This is called as gluconeogenesis. When we are on fasting for more than one day, when we do not take food for more than one day, then gluconeogenesis will occur. That gluconeogenesis will be stimulated by this glucagon hormone only. So through all these activities, by promoting glycogenolysis, by promoting gluconeogenesis pathway, this glucagon hormone increases the or raises the blood glucose levels. So in this thing, action of glucagon hormone is level. So when decrease in blood glucose levels is there, then glucagon will be released. So then glucagon binds to the receptors of the cells. So when it is bind to the receptors of the cells, then inside the cells, adenylate cyclase enzyme will be activated. This adenylate cyclase enzyme converts ATP into cyclic AMP. Okay, adenylate cyclase enzyme converts ATP molecule into cyclic AMP. So the cyclic AMP, it activates glycogen phosphorylase enzyme. This glycogen phosphorylase enzyme, it starts the glycogenolysis process. So by that, glycogen will be converted into glucose molecule. So in another pathway, this cyclic AMP, it also activates glycogen synthase enzyme. So this glycogen synthase enzyme also finally helps to release glucose molecules, and these glucose molecules finally will be released into blood, so that blood glucose level will be increased and it will come to the normal level. So in this slide, both the actions of insulin and glucagon hormones is given. Both these two things, both these two hormones work opposites to each other, but both these two things are helping us to maintain normal levels. They are not against to each other. Actually, both these two are helping us to increase the normal level. When the blood glucose levels go above the normal, insulin comes and it brings it to normal level. When the blood glucose levels are below the normal levels, then glucagon is released, and that is helping us to maintain the normal blood glucose level. So in this way, both these two things are complementary to each other in maintaining normal blood glucose levels. So next hormones will be released from adrenal gland. From adrenal gland, several hormones will be released, but out of them, cortisol hormone and epinephrine hormone, two hormones are important in regulating blood glucose concentration. First of all, let us see epinephrine. So this epinephrine will be released from adrenal medulla, and the effects of epinephrine are that it enhances the release of glucose from glycogen. So it promotes glycogenolysis process, and it also enhances the release of fatty acids from adipose tissue also. So by these two activities, it is helping us to increase the blood glucose levels. So when we are having low blood glucose levels, then epinephrine will be released, and it will help us to increase the lowered blood glucose levels to normal level. So in this slide, the action of epinephrine is given. So epinephrine molecules are shown in pink color, and the glucagon molecules are shown in blue color. Both these two things are doing the same thing. So in the liver cells, they will convert this glycogen chain. They will break this glycogen chain into glucose molecules. So glycogen will be broken down into single molecules of glucose. So these glucose molecules finally they enter into the blood, so that blood glucose levels will be increased to normal level. So like this, epinephrine and glucagon, both the things are doing the same action. And another hormone released from adrenal gland is cortisol. So this will be released from adrenal cortex region. The effect of this cortisol is that it also enhances gluconeogenesis. So when we are on fasting for 12 to 18 hours of time, then this epinephrine will help us to increase blood glucose levels. But when we are on fasting for more than one day, say for example, if you are on hunger strike, like Potti Sriramulu or KCR, then under such situations, cortisol hormone helps us to increase glucose levels. So in these situations, in this type of situations, cortisol promotes gluconeogenesis. In gluconeogenesis, the proteins which are present inside our cells, lipids which are present inside our cells will participate in gluconeogenesis. The proteins and lipids, they will be broken down, and finally they will produce glucose. So this is this cortisol hormone also is agonist to an insulin hormone like epinephrine hormone and glucagon hormone. So like this, the lowered blood glucose levels will be increased or raised to normal level. So in this thing, functions of cortisol hormone is released. So the cortisol release will be controlled by hypothalamus. So from hypothalamus, the CRH hormone will be released. So the CRH hormone comes and it promotes the release of cortisol hormone from this cortex of adrenal gland. Then from adrenal gland, cortisol will be released. So this cortisol enters into the muscle cells, liver cells. In those cells, in all those cells, it will promote the gluconeogenesis process. So when we are on fasting for a longer period of time, longer durations, then our brain will receive signals from the cells that blood glucose levels are decreased. So upon receiving that signal, brain produces this CRH, corticotropin-releasing hormone. This CRH hormone then goes into the bloodstream. Through bloodstream, it goes to this cortex of adrenal gland. Then adrenal cortex will release this cortisol hormone. Then this cortisol hormone, after going into the bloodstream, finally reaches the cells. And reaching the cells, it promotes the gluconeogenesis process. Next one is ACTH, adrenocorticotropic hormone released from pituitary gland. So this ACTH, after releasing into the cell bloodstream, after attaching with the cell surface receptors, ACTH also promoting the release of cortisol hormone from the adrenal gland, and it also enhancing the fatty acids from release of fatty acids from adipose tissue. So gluconeogenesis will be promoted from this ACTH also. So like this ACTH also is also this is also helping us to increase blood glucose levels. So this is the action of ACTH. So from hypothalamus, this nervous cells will send signals to this beta cells, gamma cells of pancreas to release the glucagon and insulin respectively. And neurons, they will send signals to this medulla and cortex of adrenal glands to release this cortisol hormone and epinephrine hormone. And this hypothalamus also sends hormones to neurohormones to pituitary gland to release ACTH. So this ACTH goes and stimulates the cortex to release cortisol hormone. And another hormone is GH. So in this thing, we are seeing all the hormones, how they are being controlled by brain hypothalamus. So in all these hormones, only insulin and somatostatin, they are increasing the they are decreasing the blood glucose levels. Remaining all glucagon and epinephrine, cortisol, ACTH, growth hormone, all these hormones are increasing the blood glucose levels. The next one is growth hormone. It is against to insulin hormone. It also raises the blood glucose levels. So how it will work, let us see. So when the blood glucose levels are reduced, then this growth hormone it promotes the secretion of ACTH, and growth hormone will be secreted from pituitary gland. So this ACTH acts as a on so the same thing has given here. So this thing growth hormone also, after coming into the bloodstream, it binds with the cell surface receptors. After entering into the cell surface, after attaching with the cell surface receptors, it promotes the glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis processes. By that, it is helping us to increase the blood glucose levels. So next last hormone is thyroxine hormone. It will be released from thyroid gland. So this thyroxine hormone also promotes the release of glucose from glycogen. So this is helping us in glycogenolysis process. And it also promotes the absorption of sugars from intestine. So after digestion is done, absorption of food materials will be performed by the microvilli in small intestine. There also, this thyroxine helps us to absorb glucose molecules. So like that also, it is helping us to increase the blood glucose levels. So the thyroxine hormone action also is helping us to raise the blood glucose levels. So on the whole, finally, so this hypothalamus also is having indirect control over the release of thyroxine. So thyroxine will be released from the action of TSH. TSH will be released by the action of TRH. So TRH will be released by hypothalamus. Okay, when hypothalamus releases TRH, then only pituitary releases TSH. Then only the thyroid releases this thyroxine hormone. So this thyroxine hormone, what it will do, it will help us in this glycogenolysis process and absorption of these things. So this is about the action of thyroxine. So another thing also there, renal regulation, it is called as renal regulation. Apart from these seven hormones, so far we have discussed, kidneys also help us in maintaining glucose levels. So one disease is there that is called as glucosuria. Glucosuria occurs when our kidneys fail to reabsorb the glucose from this ultrafiltrate. So in this thing, tubular maximum value, so tubular reabsorption is that per minute our kidneys absorb 350 milligram of glucose. So 350 milligram of glucose will be reabsorbed by the kidneys in each minute, per each minute. So and the renal threshold value is 180 milligram per milliliter. So if this threshold value is increased, that leads to the glucosuria condition. So what is the renal mechanism? When blood glucose level rises to relatively high levels, so when the normal levels are there, no problem, all the blood glucose will be reabsorbed into the blood from the urine filtrate. So, but when the glucose levels are above the normal level, then what happens? The ultrafiltrate will be having high glucose levels, but kidney is having limited capacity. So reabsorption, renal threshold value is that limited capacity. So renal threshold value is 180 milligram per ml and tubular maximum value is 350 milligram per minute. So these two values are limited. But the glucose level in the filtrate is more than these limits, so that most of the glucose will be go out of our body in the form of urine. So glucose will be continuously filtered by glomeruli, but normally reabsorbed completely in renal tubules. But blood glucose level is raised above 180 milligram per deciliter, then tubular reabsorption will not occur. So complete reabsorption will not occur when the blood glucose levels are above 180 milligram per deciliter. So we have seen that normal value should be 140 mg per deciliter immediately after taking meal. But here kidneys limit is up to 180 milligram. But beyond this 180 milligram per deciliter blood glucose levels are there, then most of the glucose filtered will not be reabsorbed into the body. So the extra glucose will pass through the urine, that is called as glucosuria. So it is called renal threshold value of glucose. So in glucosuria, what is happening? Usually normal person's urine also contains 0.05 gram per deciliter of sugar in the urine. But that is very, very negligible amount of glucose that cannot be detected by Benedict test. But when certain situations are there, like glucose sugar patients or some other disease conditions, then what happens? More amount of glucose enters into the urine filter. So then all the sugar will not reabsorbed into the body. So this will be excreted with the urine. The excretion of this urine in large quantities through excretion of glucose through urine in large quantities is called as glucosuria. So in this glucosuria, may be different types, alimentary glucosuria or renal glucosuria, kidney failure or diabetic glucosuria. So even though you do not have diabetic condition, if some kidney problems are there, so renal absorption process is damaged, then also that may lead to glucosuria. So actually you are having normal levels of insulin, but kidney problem is there. So with the kidney problem, if the glucosuria condition comes, that is renal glucosuria. If due to the problems in the insulin hormone, glucosuria condition comes, then that is called as diabetic glucosuria. And apart from these two things also, alimentary glucosuria also may be there. So in this thing, absorption of glucose will be altered. So that leads to the glucosuria conditions. So this is how glucose levels are maintained. So with this, we have finished the regulation of glucose levels in blood. In next class, we will see about thermoregulation. Till then, bye.